Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Real Talk. It's your host, Nicole Asinago, and today I am at the beautiful Brown's Cafe in Victoria Island, here to meet up with some people for a conversation you're definitely going to want to hear. On today's episode, we have the CEO of A2 Creative, Adaora Mbelu-Dania, Zippy Logistics CEO, Kabir Shagaya, popular promoter, Bizzle Oshikoya, and Misan Rewane, CEO, West Africa Vocational Education.
Yeah. Bizzle and I went to school in the Pedro, actually.
Funny. Oh, really?
Hi, guys.
Hey, Nicole.
Hi. How's it going?
Good.
I hope I didn't keep you guys waiting.
No.
Yeah? Okay. Well, today we're going to be talking about, drum roll, entrepreneurship.
entrepreneurship.
So, I don't know if you agree, but many young people today seem to have caught the entrepreneurial bug. So do you guys think that young people today are more obsessed with making it as opposed to working for it?
A lot of young people these days actually don't want to work for anybody. Everybody wants to be a boss one way or the other. And you find out that that's why you find a lot of small companies, like after like 2-3 months, they die because they don't understand. They see, oh, they see one big man doing this. But they don't know that big man goes through a lot. Like he has sleepless nights. You just wake up one day and say, oh, I want to start this business, or I want to start making clothes. But you know, it's a whole process. A lot of people don't think about this thing. They just think, oh, let me just do this process.
You just see the bright lights and the finished process.
I call it the, is it not just is it not just Taylor? Not knowing all the work that goes in the background.
Exactly.
What do you think of it?
So it's actually a very, very interesting thing because like before I started Zippy, it was probably the hardest move for me because I used to work for the Clinton Foundation. So from there, I was, you know, had a good job, very good salary, very comfortable. It was a fantastic opportunity. And also, but then from there, you know, I now decided that I wanted to start my own business. So you go from having a very good paying job to dropping all of that and then going to start from nothing. So that's the difference. So now you have, it takes a lot of humility. It's the reverse. A lot of people leave their jobs because they think, okay, I want to start my own business. I want to be able to grow. But I knew that I had a 5-year plan that how comfortable I am today, I'm not going to be that comfortable for the next 4 years. No more business class tickets. No more going out on a Friday. No more. And you literally need to make sure sacrifices at the back of your mind on a day-to-day business basis, because there's a difference between running a business and running a company. A business is a racket. Everybody just gets a deal. Okay, oh, I can supply sugar to this place and I'll be supplying them for the next 6 years. I'm supplying napkins to a hotel. That's a business. But a company is a totally different thing. You're talking about insurance, health insurance, and motor insurance and dentistry, all for your staff, having staff that have pension plans, pay their taxes, everything. And what goes into running a business, it's a totally different ballgame.
What do you think breeds this mentality of like, it's easy and let me just do it and blow? Like what breeds that mentality?
So I think there are two ways to sort of think about this side hustle thing, right? There's the idea of people who primarily want to generate side income other than what they're earning from their current place of work, right? But then there's also people who want to create and who see opportunity in terms of there's problems and we need to solve those problems, right? And I see opportunity there. I think that, you know, lots of companies also do not encourage intrapreneurship, right? I mean, in other parts of the world, right, you don't necessarily have to leave your job to create amazing products. Steve Jobs started Apple while he was working at Atari, right? Steve Wozniak, right, started designing Apple computers while he was at HP, right?
And Nike as well.
Yes, and these are people who, you know, have gone on to be extremely successful, turned their side hustle into entrepreneurship, right? I kind of view it in the sense of similar to what Kabir said, which is essentially, I mean, side hustle is like being a golfer that only golfs on weekends, right? Then, and at that point, you're an amateur. You know, that's how I see it. And then you become a professional. Being an entrepreneur is a professional. You breathe it. You're on the court every single, you're on the course every single day playing golf, you know, because that's something you want to do. I just think that, you know, it really differs depending on why you're doing it. So for some people, it's money. For some people, it's just creating. You know, I want to create stuff. I want to build something. And if those opportunities are not there within your company, I can't blame you for wanting to do that.
Funny right? You brought that up because, like, speaking of side hustles, do you think it's actually possible to balance a 9-to-5 successfully with your side hustle?
As someone who hasn't had a side hustle before, hard to speak as an expert, but I do believe in giving to Caesar what is due to Caesar. So there have been times where I wasn't as fulfilled at work and decided I was going to set up a nonprofit and go tutor kids or do other things. You have to be real with yourself. Even if you want to come home at 10 o'clock and work on side hustle from 10 to 2 a.m., when you wake up at 6 a.m. to go to work, you're not giving main hustle, you know, 100%. So you have to figure out, like Adaora, like I said, if you want to solve for just, I need income. You can't blame people for having a side hustle just because they need income. If you are trying to create something, yeah, you should. I believe in starting small. You have to start small. Don't quit your job. And yeah, I see too many people quit their job, go and try entrepreneurship and then fail. So I do believe in starting small, but also employers need to create a safe space for people to have conversations about the things that make them tick. So that if you want to build a side hustle, and that side hustle doesn't compete with what we're doing as a business and actually complements it, why can't I fund you to do side hustle within the company and give you a raise?
I tend to disagree a little bit. And I'll tell you why. Funny enough, I used to have that mentality because Zippy was a side hustle. When I was working, I started Zippy on the side. I think I did both Zippy and my job for a year and a half before I fully quit my job and I went to Zippy, because my job was funding Zippy at the beginning. That's why I don't have any investors or anything, because I was putting all my own money. Every time I get my salary, 80% goes into the company. I manage 20%. So now that was fine, everything. And I never really got what they were talking about. I was like, look, it's not affecting my performance. I'm doing my job properly, so why do you guys care? But you see, in Nigeria, it depends on what company you work for and what you do for them. Because your network is your net worth. So if I'm going to a function, if I go to a conference representing my company, and then we're discussing logistics, for example, and then you're into branding, then you're speaking to one of my clients and trying to pitch our logistics. It's, oh, by the way, I also do branding.
So you think it's unethical?
It's unethical. It depends on what position you're taking. If you're a back-end position in the company, that's fine. However, if you're front-end and you will be conversing with clients, then it can be a bit of a problem.
But I think, as you said, it's if there's a conflict in the business, right? So I've had people working for me. So we employ young people, match them to jobs in hospitality. And so the person who was doing biz dev for us also had an interior design business. So she's going to talk to employers about, oh, do you need to hire young people for your job? And also, I see that you need a renovation. I can also help with renovation.
Then what now happens when her interior design business does something really bad and there's a leakage and there's a flood?
That's her business.
Yes, but the client
is looking at you
because you are the guarantor.
No,
possibly.
In Nigeria, I'll give you an example. That's why when people ask me things like, oh, do you have a good tailor? Or do you have a good plumber? Do you have a good mechanic? I don't even leave it a disclaimer. I just say, no, I don't have. Right. Because when something goes wrong, if that guy should run away with your money, or that guy should do something to your car, you call me and say, can you imagine what that your guy did? So it's different when it's just even a friend. But imagine when it's not your employee in your company. Your company would suffer the backlash of that person's side hustle.
So are you as an employer going to ban all side hustles?
No.
Of front-end staff?
For a front-end staff.
So you're going
to
do that?
But I think it's almost impossible to do that. To be fair, I'll speak from personal experience, right? And again, it depends on the sort of business you're running, right? So within my business, for instance, we encourage everyone to be entrepreneurial, right? I would rather have entrepreneurs running my business and having an entrepreneurial mindset while they're being a part of that business, right? Than people who are just thinking about it as a job, right? So I've seen the pros of it, right? The cons, just as you said, are clear, like they're there. But the way I see it is that those things are going to happen anyway. You're not going to be able to control it. I would rather be able to control it by letting them be comfortable to discuss and say that this is what I'm doing. And so I can find ways to encourage what you're doing. And then you're seeing yourself as part of a company and you're building something that you're seeing is sustainable and long term, that maybe you might be an owner, you know, eventually on paper.
Do you think social media plays a role in this wanting to be an entrepreneur? Because you see, you know, these guys, hashtag boss.
So I think social media has played a very massive role in encouraging entrepreneurship, right? And I say that because I think about it in twofold. One is the fact that there's so many conversations happening that it makes it easier to identify problems, right? Because everyone is talking. So if I sit down and go on my Instagram every day, I can find at least one business idea a day that if I had the time and opportunity to do, yeah. I could do. Obviously, I can't do everything, but I can identify that there's a need. The second part is the fact that now you have easier accessibility to your customer. Right? So that's what social media has done. So everyone now feels, as opposed to back in the days where as an entrepreneur, you had to think about how to get to your customer. And, you know, it was a longer process, right? I mean, you had to go through so much marketing strategy and this and that. Now everyone's at your fingertip, right? Exactly. So it makes it so much easier to get your product into the market, right? Now, whether that product will fail is another conversation. Yeah. It's exactly. another conversation. And that's, exactly. you know, and yeah. I mean, that's why we have a lot of people who are rushing yeah. to market without actually taking time to consider, right, how viable their product yeah. is. Because social media sort of does that. It sometimes gives you like a false sense of opportunity. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. you're like, you know what? Yes, everybody needs this. I'm going to do it. And then yeah. you put it out and it's a flop, right? Yeah. Yeah. But again, that's what entrepreneurship is about too. I mean, that's how I see it. It's risk,
and
right?
You're continuously taking risks. Entrepreneurs so. To make sure we are also telling those stories of failure. We're True. Not just yeah. posting Agreed. When we just landed when our just, big client, exactly. but we're also exactly. telling the reflections of what we learned when exactly. we failed. So people, oh, you mean they failed exactly. one time, they did this.
Why is there a negative connotation when it comes to 9-to-5s? Like, as if you cannot progress, as if you're dull, you know, everybody else is hustling. No,
I'm not gonna lie, some people, I know people that do 9-to-5 and they make so much money and they can afford their lifestyle, they afford to travel, do so many things they want to do, and there's nothing stopping them. I know someone that has been working in a company for the past 6 years and his salary hasn't increased, you know, and he keeps complaining that he's not making enough money. Yeah. And I'm like, look for something you can do on the side to add money to you, because it doesn't even make any sense. He makes 120,000 naira a month. So every week he spends at least 15,000 naira on food. And also he spends like 6,000 naira on petrol. So that's 21,000 naira a week. 4 weeks in a month. Yeah. That's 80K. You haven't thought about rent, because in this economy where we live in Nigeria, you can't live by your salary alone. So you have to find ways.
It also depends on if you're living within your means, right. You know, because 15K a week for food is a little expensive.
Let's
you
break down that 15K a week. Mm-hmm. That's how much a day. That's about 2,000 naira a day. 2,000 naira a day, if you what you just explained now, let's just say lunch is going to cost you 700 naira.
Why would it cost you 700?
There's no way you're going.
No, there are people who are living on 35K a month. For some people.
We decided to take Real Talk to the streets.
My auntie, she don't walk. She's also a tailor. That's what she use to gain more money, to use it and do some things at home. That's it. So it's not must that you must have a job to support yourself at home.
You see Coca-Cola doing Fanta, doing Sprite, so that people can make a choice. See people like Dangote, that is doing sugar, he's doing cement. He have a reason of doing that. You are alone. You cannot be doing one and things you can sustain your family with it. It's not possible in Nigerian today.
Everything in life, there is always an advantage and a disadvantage. Yeah, the disadvantage part of it is that maybe the person will not be putting in their best, their 100% totally. But the advantageous side of it is that they both get paid. And I mean,
if you face one job, you know, say that job, if you manage to take care of you, you will face them. If you not reach, if you demand it, find another one, join and make it demand it, make it reach you to stay. Because Nigeria, as we there now, you get as you be.
Let's look at it this way, yeah. Guys. You see, because I see where you're coming from. Because let's look at social standings and classes. There's lower class, middle class, upper class. Mm. Now, a lot of people in Nigeria fall into the lower middle class category.
Just lower, yeah. Well, no, we're 200 million people. 199 million of us live in lower.
The people that we're talking about in this setting, someone that earns 120K, where would you guys put them? Middle class, lower class,
middle class.
Yeah. Okay, fine. A middle class person earns 120,000 naira a month. As a middle class person, I should not be eating 200 naira food, because that's what a lower class. So what's the meal plan for a middle class person? Can I afford lunch at a restaurant?
It depends on
the
person.
It depends. Yeah.
There are some people whose lifestyles cannot be afforded on their 9-to-5.
Yeah.
There are other people. I mean, come on. We grew up. We were raised by some of them who have worked and focused 120% on a 9-to-5, worked their way up through the ranks, and are now able to go and invest in your startup.
Yes.
Right. So it's for everybody to decide, what are you solving for in your life?
Before, in our parents' time, like you said, you know, you would have people that work somewhere 20 years, 30 years, and there's this loyalty to the company.
Right.
Obviously, that depends on how the company treats you and how they treat their employees. Mm-hmm. But young people these days, it's very rare to see somebody that's been at their job for 5 years.
Yeah. I think part of it is trust. I always say if I could sell trust in a bottle, I'd be a billionaire.
Okay.
So I don't trust as an employee that if I bust my ass off to build your organization, that you will take me along and reward me in return.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you, the employer, don't trust that I will bust my ass off for you. And so therefore, you're always trying to see how you can shortchange me.
Yeah.
I'm going to start by paying you low base, high commission. Only when I see that you bring in things, then I will increase your commission or I'll fire you. So that it's a vicious cycle as opposed to saying, look, this is what I'm trying to build. This is where I'm trying to go as an organization.
This is where.
Do you want to come with me?
Right.
These are the benefits for you if you come with me. You're going to grow these skills. You're going to grow this network. You're going to have this exposure. You're going to have this experience. You're going to get to build something and be a part of it.
And but make sure you're being honest about what you're saying as well.
Exactly. So you start from that. You start from that. Like, this is what you want to do as an entrepreneur.
Agree.
This is what you want to give the person. The person also starts from a place of honesty. This is what I want to do. You are trying to build a company that's going to Kano. I'm trying to go to Sokoto. I will come with you along to Kano. While I will after that leave and go to Sokoto, and that's okay.
Yeah.
And we have a conversation about what we do on the way from Lagos to Kano and do it really well.
Right.
And then when it's time to go off to Sokoto and you continue to Kano, we do our own thing. And
plus, you can't discount the you know the amount of experience that you gain. And experience not even in the sense of the time, right? But experience in the sense,
the
I mean, you have
the
an opportunity, skills, and you have an opportunity to, even just interaction as well,
right?
And you have an opportunity to do that on someone else's dime.
Like,
you know, you make mistakes every single day.
And
sometimes I tell my staff, I'm like,
the
mistakes that you make, right? If you realize the value, the monetary value of the mistakes that you're making, like, I don't think you can, you know, you're ready to run a business. But if you continue to make those mistakes and I allow you to continue to make those mistakes, but then I also find a way to teach you about those mistakes, then you get to the point where you're reducing mistakes, which is great for me, but you also learn
for you.
Right? Which
so
is
so guys,
for
let
you
me
too.
Give you guys a different perspective on that.
Okay.
So imagine you have a bunch of employees. You send them on a vocational training course.
Okay.
And the training course costs you, let's just say, £1,000. After you send them on the training, so they can come and work for you better as a company, they now feel that their skills have improved, so they desire more money. So how does that make sense? If I pay for you to go for training, you now come back and I have to now pay you more after I've sent you for the training that I paid for. That means as an employer, I'm suffering double.
Right.
So a lot of employers were like, no, I don't want to send my staff for training, because when I send them for training, only two things will happen. One, they'll say they want to leave and go and look for another job somewhere else. Because now look at it, their CV is going to say 5 years experience working at Zippy, and then 1 year logistics management training, then now they're ready to go
at some. And you need to ask yourself as an employer, what did I do that I didn't show that person the fuller picture of what I was trying to build and get them excited about coming with me?
I agree, but some people are just not loyal.
And some people are not
loyal.
And if you don't train them and they stay and then they go mess up the house and it falls apart and you get sued, power to you.
You know,
if you don't train yourself,
there's no one that you train and will not say they want more money.
Yeah, exactly.
Even if you train me, I'm going to ask for a raise because now I know what my value is. I know what people
that it's important to train regardless.
I think it's important to train regardless, because if you have that mentality, then you're just going to have like mediocre stuff.
Exactly.
And I have had conversations with people around, I will train you on my dime because I am going to leverage the value of that training for the next 2 years.
Right.
But it's not going to be a raise because you have gotten this value that you're taking away with you at the end of the 2 years.
What if they leave before that 2 years?
So that's what I'm saying. You have to start from a place of granting that. I'm sorry. I see it all the time. Team is 40 people strong.
Right. Yeah.
They're all millennials.
Right.
So they all have the propensity to want to leave after a year.
Right.
Yeah.
But we start from a very honest conversation. What do you want to do after Wave?
Right.
How long do I even have you for?
Right.
Oh, you have me for 2 years. This is what I want to do. Okay, then let's go.
Right.
And people will come back at the end of 2 years and say, after that 2 year thing, I really enjoyed it. What do we want to do next?
Agree.
Trust, start from a place of trust. Offer the olive branch, paint a big picture of what you're trying to do. Let the 90% who actually are good people and want to build something come with you, and the 10% who want to screw you over, they'll screw you over.
Wow, thank you guys so
Thanks
much.
For having
As
us.
The only 9-to-5 person at this table, I think I've definitely learned a whole lot. But I'll be sticking with my day job. Seems like
Thank
a lot
you.
Of work.
Well, 9-to-5 is too, if you see it that way.
We're
still
up. True.
Thank you guys so much for watching. If you want to join the conversation, please drop a comment in the comment section below. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on all social media platforms at NdaniTV. Thank you.